Here in Hawaii, we think of our islands as paradise. Pleasant weather allows us to enjoy ocean activities like surfing and paddling year-round. And sometimes, huge storm systems far off in the Pacific create incredible surfing conditions in Hawaii. Huge surf can also cause damage. The November 2003 storm provides a classic example. This video will show you amazing footage of surf damage to Hilo, and will also showcase the astonishing surfing waves that were generated. And most importantly, you will learn the difference between storm-generated surf and deadly tsunami waves. You may be able to ride big surf, but you must never try to ride tsunami waves. In late November of 2003, a large storm developed northeast of the Hawaiian Islands. Huge surf washed ashore. In Hilo, roads along the bayfront were closed, shorelines were eroded, and beach parks were flooded.
I grew up in Hilo, a Waikia High graduate. You know, you always would look out at the break wall, see if waves are coming over. I can only remember maybe one or two times where it got as bad as in late November. We had the unusual circumstance of having a storm that was to the northeast of the Hawaiian Islands with really strong winds, about 40 to 50 knots, and even stronger, blowing for a long time. The storm was pretty much stationary for a while, blowing really strong over a large area, just pointed straight at us. It was actually a combination of the low pressure system with a very strong high pressure system trailing behind it. When you have these two air masses, one with really low pressure, one with really high pressure, the difference between the two is really large. And that created the strength of winds over a large area that helped produce large swell that came into the Hawaiian Islands.
The shape of the island such that we don't often see these huge waves. We're used to trade wind swells. I'd seen really large swells in the past hit Hilo, but 20 years ago. But it's a pretty rare event that you have a storm that sits in that part of the Pacific that can aim waves right at Hilo. That storm was producing high winds for us initially before we even got the huge swell. Whenever we get high winds in the bay, the windsurfers are out there.
Well, the storm was also north and east, and so you're going to have the northeast directed shorelines getting hit. I think part of the issue with the November event was you had a piling up of the water with the repeated waves, and so that's what they call a wave setup, analogous to what happens during a hurricane with storm surge. You have a piling up of water, and when you have additional waves coming in, that just compounds, worsens the situation.
But even a foot or two can make a big difference, especially if the big swell is coming in, the large waves are striking at high tide, and then you add another foot or two to that, but then you have water across the highway.
With the November event, it was pretty close, and so I think it was pretty messy in terms of the various period waves, the spectrum of waves that came in.
The National Weather Service monitors weather conditions throughout the Pacific, and of course they have satellites and they have buoys. So they can see when the right weather conditions are coming together to produce these big swells. And then with their buoy systems, they can monitor those swells as they move out from the big storms. And civil defense is immediately alerted when conditions look dangerous.
The National Weather Service has issued a high wind warning.
It's tough to know exactly when to close any road area because there are a lot of problems. You're going to be diverting traffic and causing congestion, and you know, people don't like to be inconvenienced, especially if nothing happens. But then if you wait until too late, there's always the risk of damage or injury to people. So civil defense is in a rough position there. They can listen to all these advanced warnings from the Weather Service, but exactly when do they close the roads? Well, they usually wait till they see signs that this big storm is indeed going to begin to damage and cover the bayfront. They've been real good in the past. As soon as a few rocks get thrown across the highway, they're out there blocking off the road. But it's a tough call. They don't have an easy job. If it looks, you know, dangerous and stormy and, you know, closed out, and I don't go out. I wait for nice, clean conditions.
For the surfing waves or the ocean surface waves, what you need is a strong storm or any sort of wind blowing over the surface of the ocean, and the energy from the wave or from the storm and the winds will get translated to the surface of the ocean. Now, if you have your winds are really strong, and if they're blowing for a long time and for over a large area, that is what generates really large surf.
As they approach shore, then they begin to change. They begin to feel the bottom as they get into shallower and shallower water. With a surfing wave, we have a swell that's moving into shallow water, it's feeling the bottom, it's becoming steeper, and there's this face.
But when it goes from deep water to shallow reef, they just stand up, straight up, and pitch, and that's it. You know, it's a nice breaking wave. In waves of that size, you don't want to make any mistakes.
People went out and surfed big waves. Most of them were very experienced and had surfed bayfront before, because it's not a place for beginners. And it was still, you know, not without its risk. I saw people coming in with boards that were snapped in half. And there were, you know, stones the size of a small car that were pitched up by those big waves. You know, under normal conditions, those rocks would stay on the bottom of the bay where they've been since the last tsunami. And that gives you a good idea of just how strong those waves are, just how much energy they have. The fact that some people thought that these big waves resembled a tsunami probably stems from the fact that they'd never really seen a tsunami and that they did see damage in huge waves. Tsunami waves are nothing at all like these regular wind-generated waves that normally strike the beach.
It's caused by an earthquake many thousands and thousands of miles away.
Tsunami waves don't have that face, and they don't have that motion of the water. All the water's moving like a flood, and a flood that's filled with dangerous, deadly stuff. There's nothing you can surf. One way to think of a tsunami is to imagine that you're the size of one of those little white ghost crabs you see at the beach. Put yourself down and then look at regular-sized surf coming in. All you would probably see would be the white water at the end of that wave that broke way offshore. Well, a tsunami wave is out there in the deep ocean. The distance between crests can be 100 miles, not the 100 to 1,000 feet that you might get with a swell. And the time between crests can be 15 minutes or more, not the 15 seconds or more that you might get with regular swells. So put yourself down as that little crab, and all you're seeing is this white water that just comes toward shore and keeps coming and coming and coming. A huge tsunami might be 6 feet tall at sea, but 100 miles long. And you have to think of all that water over all that distance.
And then all that water's got to go somewhere. So when it comes back in, it just surges. So it can go up blocks, 2 or 3 blocks. How far up did it go up Wainui Nui? Pretty far. Just a big surge of water coming back. So it's just like a big mound of white water rolling in, taking buildings down, trees, cars, people.
And it's never just one wave. It's always a series of waves. When you go to the beach and see surf, you know that there's not going to be just one wave that day. There's wave after wave after wave. Well, the same thing with the tsunami. There may be a dozen waves spread out over 2 or 3 hours. So nothing at all like the waves you surf, and absolutely nothing that you could survive if you were out there trying to surf a regular swell when a tsunami struck. And bear in mind that after that first tsunami wave washes in, it's going to pick up everything in its path. It's going to pick up rocks and trees and houses covered with roofing iron, and it's going to suck all that back out to sea, and the second wave is going to have all that in it.
The tsunami, it's not a surfable wave. I mean, you've got a displacement of water that's the whole water column in the ocean that's moving up on the shore, and it comes in with all this debris in it too, because you're going to have this series of waves coming in and out, and there's not going to be a nice wave face that surfers like to travel on. It's just this wall that comes in.
So it's definitely something we don't ride. We don't even think about it. Do not try to attempt to ride a tsunami. I seriously doubt you could duck dive.
You can't get underneath it because it goes from the top to the bottom. It's the entire water column. It's all the water that's moving toward shore. When tsunami waves are coming in, the water withdraws, and a lot of people have been lured out in areas to see the freshly exposed seafloor that you won't normally see. And that's just deadly. You would never want to do that. And because a tsunami can last several hours, you'll only know that it's safe when civil defense tells you it's safe. You wait to hear the all-clear siren before you would ever go into any inundation zone. The next time we have a tsunami warning, your first thought should be for you and your family to be in a safe area. If you're not in the inundation zone, you're already safe. If you are, then you should know where you need to go to evacuate. And once you're outside the inundation zones, these have been determined by civil defense to be safe areas, that's as close as you want to be. We here in Hawaii also create our own tsunamis. You know, most tsunamis are created by big earthquakes scattered around the rim of the Pacific, but here in Hawaii we have our own earthquakes that are capable of generating tsunamis. And the last one occurred in 1975 and was most devastating along the south coast of the island, just off where the earthquake was centered. And there were 2 casualties at a place called Halepe in the national park.
These size local earthquakes happen periodically, and they've happened before, and they're going to happen again. In situations like that, because the tsunami happened so fast after the earthquake, you really have to pay attention to local clues. If you feel a strong earthquake and you're near the shoreline, just head for the hills. Head to higher ground immediately. Don't wait for the evacuation notice to come in, because it's going to be too late.
At Halepe in 1975, there was less than 5 minutes from the time of the earthquake to when the huge waves came ashore. If you feel an earthquake that's large enough that you have trouble standing up, then that's big enough to have created a tsunami. If I'm at the beach and I feel an earthquake, I'm not going to wait around to pick up my bodyboard and my fins. I'm going to grab my kids and head to high ground immediately.
There will be more surfable waves out there. There'll be more chances. But if you try to go out there and we have a tsunami warning out and the wave does come in, you're on your last chance. That's it. Become a statistic.
Nidos knows what tsunamis are, and I think if you hear of a tsunami, you want to go to high ground right away. Get your loved ones and go. Don't wait around.